start out and just say, you know, personally, I'm not actually a technical person, unless you count that degree from 20 years ago and my certificate in networking. What I'm super excited about is how technology innovation actually drives change and our opportunity to help people be in front of that, to get comfortable with it, to want to ride those waves of change, because they come crashing down on us every few years in the tech industry. You actually can't wait for change. It's gonna be there in front of your face every morning when you wake up. So we're gonna be moving at cloud speed today, and I want your students to be successful. I want them to have job opportunities. And I've been at NetApp for about 12 years. You've heard a lot about NetApp today. So NetApp, if you haven't heard of it, it's a $6 billion company that's been around for about 25 years. We have 30,000 customers around the world, and in case you thought hardware was dead, in the last couple of quarters, we've actually been outgrowing the market in our flash system sales. So those all-flash arrays are going off the shelf like hotcakes right now. And NetApp is an amazing company. You heard a little bit about some of the fun things that I get to do there. Patrick actually precedes me at NetApp by a few years, so it's definitely a company worth spending some time with. And what we really care about as a tech company is empowering our customers to change the world with data. And so I want to tell you just one quick story to kind of give you perspective on what that looks like. Planet Labs is a NetApp customer who images the entire surface of the planet Earth every single day with 140 satellites. Imagine the scope of that data. I know you think the kids in your classes are posting that much data to Instagram on a daily basis. But the data at Planet Labs has an opportunity to change the world. It's telling farmers where to plant their crops. It's telling disaster relief agencies where the bridge is out, where they can go to help people. And that's the power of data. And that's why, even though NetApp is a storage company, what we really care about is the data. And with data of that scale, and this is just one customer, we want to think about some of the terminology that you've been hearing this week. And I'll kind of paint a little bit of a picture. We're going to talk, and Patrick has told me, I should talk a little bit about some definitions of what's a public cloud, what's a private cloud, what's a hybrid cloud, because you want to know where that data is. And the most efficient place to put it when you're talking about these epic scales. You heard on Monday from Professor Prism about serverless architecture. And he talked about cloud, and he did a wicked amazing job of telling you about tons of technologies. And yesterday, Tom talked at lunch a little bit about some of the digital evolution and the trends that are influencing the industry to get us closer to some of those holy grails of automation and connectivity everywhere. So today I'm going to be kind of in the middle. I can't go as fast as Professor Prism, and I think Tom painted a great big picture of how the world is changing. So I'm going to narrow that down a little bit and talk about what are some of the business motivators that are driving this cloud growth. So we'll start by talking about hyperscalers. And this is a term that we use all day, every day in the storage industry, but it's something that you might not be familiar with. So who are hyperscalers? These are the four big players. It's Amazon, it's Microsoft, it's IBM and Google. And they are investing billions of dollars to build out compute, networking, and storage capacity for their public cloud customers. It's not a fad or a trend. It's amazing the scope and scale of what they've done. I went to an AWS summit in April, and I kind of drank the Kool-Aid a little bit. I heard Andrew Jassy, who runs Amazon Web Services, talk about the 90-plus offerings they have, services layered on top of the cloud. And you heard Professor Prism talk about it. I think we saw a video of Lambda. You might not know about everything that they offer built on top of that compute and storage capacity, but you might not know that just in the last year, Amazon acquired 23,000 new database customers, maybe not all on Dynamo, but they are growing fast, and the market actually is rewarding them richly. So tremendous revenue from Amazon. And if you look at where that market is going, the public cloud market is expected to be $141 billion in 2019. It's incredible. So when we think about that scope and the scale, clearly there's something happening here. There must be a reason that customers are willing to go and put their data out in the cloud. It empowers a business. When you think about the world today, things are changing fast. And the business model of yesterday might not make us successful today. And I don't know about you, I mean, we spent a little bit of money this week, thankfully, everything my boss approved. But in the IT world, the budgets are shrinking. Norm and I were just chatting about how hard it can be to actually get some hardware into your data center when you need it. So there are these tremendous business drivers behind why customers, why businesses are moving their data into the cloud. Because it gives them efficiency, it gives them speed, it gives them flexibility. And I think that's really important, is to understand that there are business drivers behind that growth in the cloud. It gives them these opportunities to change the way they do business and to move much more quickly. So let's talk about just a couple of those use cases. And again, we'll talk about what the barriers are, but if you're opportunistic and you're thinking about, hey, I want to spend less money on my IT infrastructure, and I want to get to market faster. I want to grow my customer base. I might move to cloud because it's going to eliminate a lot of those barriers. Think about a procurement process to build a new data center. Think about your carbon footprint. And we just heard Dr. Johnson talking about, hey, we have to build all these new buildings and build a new technology center. That takes a long time, but if I want to move fast, I'm going to go to the cloud because all of that compute, all of that storage, all that networking is ready for me and it's just sitting there waiting. So we're going to move fast on providing better services to our customers and our internal stakeholders. We're also going to do creative new business ideas. Let's say I have this crazy idea, my boss approves it, and it's going to take a lot of IT investment for me to go spin up this possible new line of business. I'm not going to get to build my data center, and my idea's not going to wait. But for a creative new business opportunity, I might be able to tap into one of these hyperscalers, get everything I need to test something for a week or a month or a year. And if that business fails, I shut it all down. I don't have to worry about paying that recycling fee for all that hardware I just bought that I don't need anymore because I went out of business. So also think about companies in the startup world. Uber, Slack, Nextdoor. These are some of the companies that started 100% in the cloud. They never had an IT infrastructure. And they moved quickly, got to market first, and look at the results. And the last thing, when we think about optimizing operations, all data is not the same. Some data deserves to be riding around in a Ferrari. Right? But some data might need a minivan. Sometimes we don't need anything at all. We're done with the data. Maybe it's out on tape. But there's a lot of different reasons where in your business you might want to optimize where you put your data. And that's, we'll start to talk a little bit about kind of this hybrid cloud in a minute, because all data is not equal. All data should not be treated the same. But we're also kind of scared. And I heard three or four questions during the last two lunch presentations about why would I ever want to put my stuff in the cloud? That's terrifying. So I want to address security concerns. I want to talk a little bit about the government and their cloud use. And I want to talk about privacy laws, because somebody brought up, what are the lawyers going to say and how many lawyers do you need? So I know some great lawyers. So I'll talk just briefly, you know, when you're thinking about, as a business, do I put my data out in the cloud? Do I trust that that cloud is going to treat my data with the utmost security? We can say that was actually 5 years ago, 10 years ago. You know, one little side note, I worked at a peer-to-peer compute startup company in the early 2000s. and all of our customers, we were targeting pharma and the financial industry. You know, they're running their Monte Carlo calculations on their super proprietary data. You know, they didn't want to try out our peer-to-peer compute solution because they were so worried about data security. They wouldn't even trust their own employees' desktop machines to have that data and those calculations running. So security has been a concern forever. It is the number one concern of all the companies who are touching data in the cloud. And so there's encryption, there's policies. There are a lot of ways that we're securing your data in the cloud, just like a bank secures your money. Of course, you hear about security concerns because just like a bank can get robbed, there's an inside job, right? That no matter what level of security you have, there's always going to be some bad actor who wants to try to take your data from you. But basically, I think we've gotten to a point where we're pretty comfortable with putting our data in the cloud. I'll ask you this personal question. Do you have a free email account? Where is that data? It's been there. It's been in the cloud this whole time. So we're trusting our email to be in the cloud as consumers. Most businesses trust their email to be in the cloud now as well. Because Microsoft Exchange is a cloud service. Your email isn't sitting in an Exchange server behind all of your business walls. It's sitting at Microsoft now. And then if you start to think, well, that's just my email. I don't care about my email. Do you do your taxes online?
No.
All right. Because a lot of us are comfortable putting our taxes online. Where is that?
Cloud.
It's in the cloud.
Yep.
Right, so I think we've been trained over time to lower those security fears. And in fact, we're not the only ones now trained that the cloud can be a safe place. As early as 2010, the federal US government had a cloud first mandate. And they've doubled down every couple of years saying, you cannot build a new data center until you've evaluated cloud to meet your needs. They even created an organization, FedRAMP, to help all of their organizations get into the cloud. And in case you don't believe me, because you think all those three-letter acronym agencies would never put their data in the cloud, these are customers that have publicly said, my data is in the cloud. And so your IRS tax filings are in the cloud. Veterans benefits are in the cloud. The Mars rover images come down from another planet into the cloud, which is pretty awesome, right? So you can do your visa application online. And yeah, there's one up there that's big and shiny, and it's a three-letter acronym agency. The CIA is in the cloud. So a public cloud provider, Amazon, went to the CIA and said, would you like some cloud? They said, yes, please, but could you build it in our data center? Could you put the Amazon cloud in our data center? And what is that? That's a private cloud. So absolutely, the government trusts and puts data in the cloud. Now, the government loves your data so much, it also wants to regulate it, and this is where the lawyers come in. I had to shorten this list because it would have been unreadable if I included every single agency that thinks it has the right to regulate your data. And businesses have to be aware of all the laws, not just in the United States, but the European Union came together and drafted legislation, the General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR, which says that data, individual consumer data, has sovereignty in specific countries. You actually can't move your data. If you're a German citizen, your data isn't going to go to Austria. So laws are saying where data can even move. And when you think about the cloud, it's just some big data center in the sky. There's a tremendous opportunity here. These laws create opportunities because they say there's not going to be one data center to rule them all. Right? There's going to be lots of data centers. And in fact, Amazon and all of these hyperscalers are building data centers in different places because of these laws. So when you think again, you know, there's no more hardware, there'll never be a data center, here come these laws. And they're confusing, and you will need lawyers, and you have to be very careful about when you make that cloud commitment. Because as a customer, look, I just want my data, man. I just want my data. And my data is moving all around, it's changing all the time, it's growing, expanding, I'm getting it from different sources, and it needs to be able to do a lot of different things. So it's complex. So there's not a one-size-fits-all answer when it comes to data that needs to go all around the world and do different things and serve all my needs, and it needs to do that fast. And so that's why this hybrid cloud concept is going to be around for the next 10 years. And it's not me saying it, but it's also the boss of Amazon Web Services, the guy who does want to rule the world. If anybody brought anything on Prime Day yesterday, Mark, I don't know if you got my box yet, but I did some shopping, right? Andrew Jassy says that for the next 10 years, there will be on-prem data centers. Businesses will want to have their traditional IT model and put data in the cloud. And so that's where, when we talk about hybrid cloud, it's because your data is going to be in lots of places. And so what is critical is being able to move that data to different places. And so we're just going to do, this is like a review. I don't actually like this slide very much, but I wanted to include it. Because when we think about some of these key terms that I've mentioned, we talk about public cloud. That's the stuff that's sitting out at the hyperscalers. We also talk about the CIA having its own private cloud or enterprise cloud, right? On-prem is here at Collin College. On-prem is here at your college. It is your location. Off-prem is somewhere in the cloud. So we talked about public, private, on-prem, off-prem. Look out. Unless you want to get a whole bunch of Amazon snowmobiles in here and ride those from data center to data center, from cloud to cloud, we need to make sure that all of this interconnects. And that is really important. Tom talked about it yesterday. We're not there yet. But that's actually, like, again, if I come back to NetApp, NetApp is really passionate that it's your data, you should have it your way every day, wherever you want it. And so we're focused on that interconnectivity and building a fabric behind all that data so you can have it in your data center one day, in the cloud the next day, and then move it back to a different data center. Because that's what the future looks like. Your data goes with you wherever you want it. And I got a really good example yesterday that I think is relevant. A friend of mine who works for another data storage company told me about their customer, a university in Italy. They store all their student data on Microsoft Azure. Because when the students are done being students, they want their students to be able to take that data with them into the future. And so it's a very simple process for it to be on that university's cloud and then go with the student afterwards. So that's the kind of movement and flexibility that we're talking about. And if we think about an IT career in this world, we need to understand it's wildly complex. But there's still those fundamentals. There's still a set of fundamentals that every student is going to need to learn. You cannot be as good as Professor Prism and learn every single thing you need to know in one week at one conference. It's really good to understand that that whole world exists, but I believe that students still need the fundamentals and that there will be hardware, at least for the next 10 years, until the robots rule some epic data center somewhere, right? And until Skynet takes over, we should be thinking about, you know, do our students understand these fundamental concepts, and can they touch some hardware one day, but also be really focused on workflow automation and scripting the next day? And so that's where, you know, I kind of want to leave you with a couple of ideas of what do you do to prepare? Because the world is changing. You have been through these changes before. You know it's not going to stop. We just finished with, like, virtualization. Virtualization was going to kill hardware, right? Virtualization was going to put storage companies out of business. No, we're still here. We talked about this. Even though we're selling flash like hotcakes, tape still exists. And Anne mentioned I worked at Xerox. I worked at Xerox when we had the e-paper initiative. We were going to have the paperless office, but how many pieces of paper are still here? Right, so we need to be realistic about how quickly that hardware is going to go away and everything is going to solve itself. But I want you to remember, foundational knowledge is still key. And that software skills are critical. More and more in every job, people need to know a language, they need to be able to script something, and they're probably going to be able to master cloud architects sitting behind a terminal and orchestrating things across multiple data centers, multi-cloud, hybrid cloud. And to do that, you actually, like I said, I don't think you have to know everything because it changes so fast. But check out an AWS summit. I did that in April, it's totally free. There's coming up in Chicago and Atlanta and New York. Sign up, register, go to one. Check some stuff out, talk to some people. It's exciting and it's fun. You drink that Kool-Aid for a day and you want a job at Amazon, I'm telling you. But also, did you know that right now, Business Insider just published, I think last week, an article on the top three skills in the tech industry. One of them is Amazon Web Services certification. Has anybody already done that cert in this room?
Which cert is that?
Amazon Web Services certification. Check it out. So you can get it for like $200 or less. You can do the curriculum online, Udemy, a lot of those places. I'm asking you, think about it. Take that certification, and then what could you do to prepare your students to pass that certification? It's one of the number one recommended job skills to have in the IT industry. The other thing I'm looking at, Bill, is IoT. Understanding IoT is critical. And the last piece you actually heard about from Professor Chrisom on Monday was understanding containers and serverless architecture. All these things go together, right? You're in the right space to be having these conversations. And I think it's really compelling. But also imagine the future that Tom described, digital cohesivity. What kind of jobs might there be? You might not be working in an IT role. You might not be in a data center. At NetApp, one of these great new hires we have was an engineering student who came to work in sales. So those job choices might be very different. So we need students who are flexible, adaptable, that know software, but also understand the foundation of technology. And I'll just mention, I think certifications are really important. And I have an amazing class who's going through our NetApp Hybrid Cloud certification program this week with Patrick Magnificent, our instructor. So thank you guys. And if you want to learn more about that, chat with us, tweet at us, or talk to us. And if you know a full curriculum around certification is not your idea of fun, then we also have some other offerings. So I just wanted to mention that. And I also wanted to challenge you. I want to challenge you. Because I'm standing up here today, like I said, I could have been working in food service. But instead, I have a change leadership role at a 25-year-old tech company that wants to change the world. So what are you going to do to ensure that your students are ready for that future? That 20 years from now, your student is standing on stage saying, my professor helped me achieve greatness. I'm not calling myself great, but I know your students are. And I know you can help them get there. So thank you.